Okay, now we're going to talk about fleet management. And this is a really easy spot to make some improvement. How many companies represented here would have their own transport fleets in-house? A few? Yep. Or you have a dedicated contractor maybe doing delivery services for you. Yep. A few of those. Okay, so this will give you some tips on what to look at with those guys. So why is poor fleet management an issue? Look, you end up with high cost, poor service, basically. You end up with locked in contractors. You have a lack of flexibility. So what happens particularly where you've got a distribution fleet that's been in place for a number of years, it ends up operating to meet the fleet structure or the fleet owner rather than the needs of the business. So let's have a look at some of that. And, you know, inefficient fleets come around for a number of reasons. People don't have inefficient supply chains because they've, you know, woken up and had a bad day and decided to screw things up. It generally happens because a business changes over time. And it might be, you know, 2 years, 5 years, 20 years, and no one's bothered to actually restructure the warehouse network or the delivery fleet or whatever. And so very often you'll inherit something which is really inefficient. So it might be historical. It was never designed. I mean, how many companies actually design their distribution network or their distribution fleet from scratch? You normally inherit something and you're just trying to improve it. Maybe they've acquired businesses, they've divested businesses, maybe the range has changed, customers have changed, maybe something in the regulatory environment. We did a lot of work up in Southeast Asia, and some time ago, for example, the government in Bangkok decided to restrict large vehicles coming into the city area. There's basically a circle whereby through certain hours of the day, only small trucks can go inside that circle, six-wheel trucks, they refer to them as. That would really turn your distribution on its head when things like that happen. So they have to come in through transshipment centers on the outskirts of the city and then deliver with smaller vehicles. And maybe you've changed your sourcing. So all sorts of things can impact how you're doing your distribution. So again, let's just talk through a couple of case studies and then a little bit of theory. So here is one on Thailand. Funnily enough, we have a project going on there next week on distribution. So this particular company was distributing industrial products all over Thailand. And the example I'm talking about was their branch just down here in Chonburi. And it was very interesting talking to the branch manager about how they were doing their distribution. And the story went something like this. On Monday, we deliver north into Bangkok, or the outskirts of. On Tuesday, we deliver up here. On Wednesday, we go down here. On Thursday, we do the long distance ones down to Trat. And on Friday, we do emergency orders. Think about that for a minute. What if I have an emergency on a Monday? So that worried me. But also, it was the set routes. You know, so what if I'm here and I want a delivery on a Tuesday? No, Thursday's your day. Very rigid and sort of old-fashioned. So they had no concept of let's get all the customer orders together and day by day we'll schedule them. You know, and you don't need fancy systems for scheduling. You can do it on a whiteboard if there aren't too many deliveries. I actually remember working 20 years ago with one of our big grocery retailers that is no more, and they were scheduling about 100 vehicles on a whiteboard with magnetic slats. You know, here's all the deliveries. They'd write it on the slat, and it was, you know, and they'd shuffle them around through the day. The system just does that faster. And so all these guys did, they had about 12 vehicles in this branch, was just lump all of that in together and make a little bit more sense of when they're doing the deliveries. It was far more efficient. And this one, this has got to be some of the hardest distribution ever. So ready-mix concrete. And the orders come in maybe a few days in advance. Depending on the weather, we might adjust the orders. Depending on the weather this morning, we might be planning to pour at 6 o'clock, but now we're not. Can we knock it back? What do you do with a ready-mix truck that's already mixing and it's on the way to... Apparently, they try to sell it to another customer, or they take it to a quarry, which is very expensive, and pour it before it goes hard. I'm so fascinated with this. I'm talking to cement, and we're going to go out and do a site visit. We'll be taking the academy members out in July to do a site visit to the customer service center to see how they handle all of that, because it just blows my mind. I don't know how they do that. So this is the little bit of theory that we're talking about. And what you need to understand in a delivery operation is that you've got to have a bit of science around how you use the vehicles. And if you understand these concepts, you can do this on a whiteboard. Basically, what happens is the delivery from the warehouse has a stem distance. This is basically the distance that I have to drive to get into my area of distribution. And this is used to be known as the traveling salesman algorithm. So it was invented decades ago in the US. How can I make my traveling salesman more efficient? So this guy's going to go to Canberra. That's his stem distance. And then I want him to call on 20 potential customers. Which sequence should he do them in? And then drive back. Bearing in mind, he can only visit the customers between 9 and 2 or whatever it is. Exactly the same when we're delivering products. So we need to understand the stem distance for the customer. We've got some fixed cost and variable cost related to running the fleet. We've got our inter-drop distance. And basically what we need to do is to start grouping these customers together and taking account of the time and distance and the various costs. So what you're trying to achieve is a very high density of drops within the drop zone so that we're not traveling too much between customers. And you know what happens in a lot of companies, and particularly when delivery routes have grown up over time? Can you hear that? I did put it on silent. I don't know why it's not turned off. What happens when delivery routes grow up over time is people say, oh, look, we're over here anyway. We can add that customer here, and it's only a slight incremental cost. And we can add that one in here, and it's only a slight incremental cost because we go past them anyway. And all of the route ends up being built around small incremental costs. And your cost of distribution is just going up and up all the time. So this can be a key component of understanding your cost to serve. So we want to know what's the fixed and variable cost of doing each delivery. As an example, I've probably done this with most of the milk companies, the bread companies, the chicken companies, and spent a lot of time sitting with drivers, you know, delivering bread and so on. I mean, a bread delivery driver might do 50 or 60 drops when he's delivering bread to small stores and so on. The difficulty they have is the time window of when they're doing the deliveries. So they might start at 4 in the morning and they've got to finish at 10. What do you reckon is the one thing that you can do with your customers, negotiating with your customers, to make that whole thing far more efficient? What do you think the biggest constraint is? Yes. Open and closing time, dock times. Yeah. So traffic, you're right. We don't want to be delivering in peak hour. But the one thing that will make the biggest difference is this person who says, I've got to have my delivery between 6:30 and 7 in the morning. Could you make it 6:30 to 7:30? You do that with all your customers and just open those windows a little bit and then use a routing system to do this. Bingo. You're going to save 10 or 15% in distribution costs. That is the biggest constraint. And in some industries, of course, what happens is everybody wants their delivery between 6 and 10. So that becomes a little bit more difficult. And then you've got to negotiate and say, well, if we could drop in the afternoon, we could reduce the cost of it. Bit of useless information. When are the peak periods for selling bread? What time? Before and after school, 1 hour windows. That's when all the bread goes flying off the shelves. Nightmare for bread delivery companies. So I once did some work with a bread delivery company where we looked at a chaos distribution system. So basically we had full truckloads of bread out on the streets. And then, you know, come 3:30, 4 o'clock, as shops were running out, you could just call it in, you know, 100 loaves to Coles, North Rocks, whatever. So the consequences of having inappropriate fleets, you know, you're going to end up with a lot of excess cost, lack of flexibility, excess resources. You know, if nobody has looked at this in your business, it's well worth having a look, whether you're managing that fleet yourself Or if you've got carriers doing it for you, I'll be saying, how are you planning all these drops? Show me how the sequences work. Oh, well, Fred always does that part on a Thursday. Yeah. No, doesn't work like that. And so if you were to sort of say, how do you go about this, looking at your distribution like this, the three main elements, the customer, where are they, the order profile, and the time windows, that's the big one, the vehicles, what's their capacity, what's their fixed and variable costs, what are the access constraints, and the network, what's your service offer, collection versus delivery, and your depot locations. That's pretty much what you've got to look at when you're looking at distribution. And easily 15% opportunity there if you've never looked at it. Okay, so some key things to look at. Is the service offer right? Keep coming back to this. What's the service offer your customers want that you want to give to them? If that changes, it changes everything. So are you able to differentiate service amongst your different types of customers? The drop size and the frequency drives the cost. That's come up time and time again this morning and will continue to this afternoon. And think about capacity and time utilization. So that delivery window is the key. If we can open up that delivery window, or can you use larger trucks? And again, I'm going to keep reminding you, the goal here is to do less frequent, larger deliveries. No, the customers don't want that, but once you know what the trade-offs are in your own business, you can give them incentives to get them to do that.